clink.
Hello, everybody. How are you guys doing? All right. Well, I know most of you guys. If I don't know you, I'm Stephen Felix Yeager. I'm a professor here, chair of Worship Arts and Media. Yes. So today we have a special service for you guys. And I wanted to kind of give you a little bit of instruction, talk a little bit about how our posture should be during this. You guys know we're in Holy Week, and this is the most pivotal thing, you know? Jesus is the most important, right? And we have a class in our program called Creative Arts and Worship. And in that class, yep, some of you guys are, yes, all right. And in that class, we actually learn how to design a worship service that uses a whole bunch of different artistic elements, experiential elements, and all sorts of stuff like that. And we do a service. And so this is that service. And so it is a class assignment, but we don't want you guys to think of this as a class assignment. Like, we were praying back there, and we were like, Jesus, this is for you. We love you so much. First and foremost, before anything else, you need to be glorified in this. One thing that happens a lot of times is during Easter, we focus, I think, so quickly on the resurrection. Rightly so, it's one of the most important things that ever happened, right? But we can't gloss over the fact that Jesus died. In order to get to a resurrection, Jesus had to die. And to think that God becoming one of us and then dying for us, I think we need to set in this and focus on this. The service today is actually a Good Friday service. There's this type of service called the Stations at the Cross, where you have 14 different parts of the Passion narrative that are all broken down of different things that happened in those last 12 hours of Jesus' life. And we're just going to focus and zero in. There's going to be different elements. Some of them are going to be interactive, okay? So some of them are going to be, you'll see some stuff and you guys are going to be involved. There's communion here. All this stuff is going to all be part of the service. So what I ask you guys to do is to have a posture of worship and reverence. It's not like straight up silence, you know what I mean? We're going to be singing together. We're going to be standing up and singing and doing all that kind of stuff because we're still Pentecostal, you know what I'm saying? But we still at the same time, we need to kind of focus in on the cross and what Jesus did for us, okay? Let's pray. Father in heaven, I praise and glorify your name. And I just thank you for this day. And I thank you for my brothers and sisters in Christ here. Lord, what a privilege it is just to be able to worship you here today as one community. God, I don't know exactly how it works in your cosmic vision of past, present, and future. But Lord, we hope that today, that this act of worship that we're giving you, that you see it even when you're hanging on the cross. That you are glorified and that it helps to keep you with the mindset of remembering why you did what you did. We're your children, adopted and loved. God, you're so good. You're the most important. Be glorified. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yes, not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went away a second time and prayed. "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed a third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Comes my betrayer."
It's been 3 years since the day when he saw me in the crowd and he called me out by name. Who was I to be a student of the one we've waited for? At first my spirit leapt with joy that he saw something within me that he wanted to employ. In great anticipation, I left everything to help him fight the war. and all that I could sing was hallelujah. Our warrior has come. At last our great Messiah comes to set us free from Rome. The man who stands before us is the answer to our woes. And what else could he have picked me for if not to kill our foes? But as the months were passing by, he never called me to action or violence of any kind. He had no use for my skills of war or the knife inside my sheath. There must be some misunderstanding. What were all my years of training for if he commands us to just endure all the pain and the agony, the cruelty and the tyranny? What use is a Messiah that only turns the other cheek? And oh, Messiah, you're not the one I know. You're not the one I heard about in the prophecies of old. Why won't you hear your people as they cry out to our Father for freedom? And oh, Messiah, are you who you said you are? You heal the Roman servant as though he were your own child. Have you lost your mind? Have I followed you for nothing? And then he told the 12 of us that those who live in righteousness will have their needs forever satisfied. I started to believe again. I said aloud, but Jesus went. He told me he must first be crucified. What? Crucified, did I hear him right? Crucified, he said, crucified, crucified. You're joking, right? The Messiah can't be crucified. I won't believe it, it can't be right. I can't believe after all this time that this man truly is divine. It was all just one big... It was a lie. It was one big lie. He can't free us. He'll never free his people. We'll always be suffering. Well, if he won't fight, if he ignores our pains, then he should pay the price at the hands of those who keep us all in chains. So I ran to the priests in the city and I told them all I knew. I told them that I was a disciple of his, that I'm the guy for you. But not so fast, nothing is free. Give me an offer and I'll see what I think. 30 pieces of silver in a scarlet pouch was all I needed to sell him out. I take your offer, the deal is done. When I kiss his cheek, you'll know he's the one. I take him away, I don't care how far. So be behind bars. So Messiah, what now will you do? If you will not free Israel, we'll take you captive too. So I led them to the garden where he sat in restless prayer. He told me he would be there. I ran to him with a sly embrace. I kissed him on the cheek. Sweat was red as blood. His face was filled with agony. The crowd took him away, and he never tried to fight back or talk back or retract. And it was over. It's
It's been 3 years since the day when I saw him in the crowd and he called me out by name. Now I stand here with a pouch full of silver and a heart full of shame. And as the sun begins to set, I hear the awful news that throws my stomach into knots. What? Crucified, did I hear them right? Crucified, they said, crucified, crucified, they can't be right. My teacher can't be crucified. I ran back to the priest and I said, take it back from me. All my silver, take it all back. Take it all back, please. Please take it back. I threw my silver, every piece, on the temple floor for all to see. And all I felt was agony. And I ran outside to find a tree. I threw my Savior's life away, so I know what must be done. My life will end by these same hands, the hands that sold the Son. At daybreak, the council of the elders of the people, both the chief priests and the teachers of the law, met together, and Jesus was led before them. If you are the Messiah, they said, tell us. Jesus answered, if I tell you, you will not believe me, and if I asked you, you would not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the mighty God. They said, are you then the Son of God? He replied, you say I am. Then they said, why do we need any more testimony? For we have heard it from his own lips.
How many times? How many times have I acted like I didn't know you? How many times have I set aside my faith to make room for human approval, to make room for my agenda, to make room for me? Oh, my soul, oh, my Savior, Peter denied you 3 times, but I've denied you more. I was standing right there, watching as you were beaten, shamed, spat on, and scorned, and I looked right past, like you don't know me for all I am. Like you didn't go through all of this for me, just because you love me. Oh, my soul, oh, my Savior, Peter denied you 3 times, but I've denied you more. How many times? How many times have I acted like I didn't know you? Too many. Too many to be worth all of this, but you still gave your life for me. Oh, my soul, oh, my Savior, Peter denied you 3 times, and I have denied you more.
Now, it was custom at the festival to release a prisoner whom the people requested. A man called Barabbas was in prison with the insurrectionists who had committed murders in the uprising. The crowd came up and asked Pilate to do for them what he usually did. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews? Asked Pilate, knowing it was out of self-interest that the chief priests had handed Jesus over to them. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have Pilate release Barabbas instead. What shall I do then with the one you call king of the Jews? Pilate asked them. They shouted, what crime has he committed? Pilate asked, but they shouted louder. Wanting to satisfy the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus flogged and handed over to be crucified.
I invite you all to stand for this song we're going to sing. As we come face to face with the humanity of our Savior. Here we go.
Oh, the perfect Son of God, in all his innocence, here walking in the dirt with you and me. He knows what living is, he's acquainted with our grief, a man of sorrows, the Son of suffering, blood and tears. How can it be there's a God who we a God who believes? Oh, praise the one who would reach for me. Hallelujah to the Son of suffering.
And some imagine you are distant and but you chased us down in merciful pursuit. To the sinner you were grace, and the broken you embrace. And in the end, the proof is in your wounds. Oh, in the end, the proof is in your wounds. The blood and tears. How can it be there's a God who weeps? There's a God who bleeds. Oh, praise the one who reached for me.
Finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified. So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull. I want to invite you guys to take your seats. So if you guys look in the aisles, there are pencils and paper. You guys can pass that to one another. We're going to take a second to... We're going to sing about the road that Jesus took on the way to be crucified. And as we are singing this song, I encourage you all to just think about whatever burdens, whatever worries that you want to leave at the foot of the cross today. In just a second, the cross is going to be right here on display for all of us to see. And I want you guys to really ask the Lord, what is it that I need to surrender to you? What is it that I've been putting above you? And I encourage you all to leave it at the foot of the cross today to be buried with our Savior.
Jerusalem that day, the soldiers tried to clear the narrow street, but the crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating, there were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head, and he bore with every step the scorn of those who cried out for his death. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way of suffering, soldados le abrían paso a Jesús, mas la gente se acercaba para ver al que llevaba aquella cruz, por la vía dolorosa, que es la vía del dolor, como oveja vino
I don't belong here. I really don't. Paradise is the last place I expected to end up. After all I've done, I was next to him.
I was next to him, guilty, bitter, bruised and bloody, just like him. We were the same.
We were the same, and he didn't deserve it. This man, this savior, hung next to me was innocent. They treated him like one of us.
Like one of us. He had everyone's attention. If he was going to do something, now was the time. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. But no response. Who was this guy?
Who was this guy? Don't you fear God? This is what we deserve. This is our punishment. This is our cross to bear. But he's done nothing wrong.
He's done nothing wrong, right? Then why is he here? Why won't he do anything to stop this? If I was him...
Forgive them, Father. They don't know what they are doing.
He was stolen from, killed, destroyed, hanging vulnerable between two thieves. And he understood. He understood them. He understood us. He understood me.
Me. He doesn't even know me. Who is this man to ask for forgiveness for me? Who does he think he is? The Messiah.
The Messiah? We lock eyes, and it's like he can see right into me. Like he can see who I am. Every crime I've ever committed, every lie I've ever told. And the craziest part is, there's no shame in his eyes, just love. I speak before thinking, and my voice breaks. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
And through a shuddering breath, Jesus answers.
Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise.
Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home.
We're going to go into a time of communion. The night before Jesus died, he had supper with his disciples, and he took the bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them saying, "Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." I just want to take this moment to sit in remembrance of the sacrifice that Jesus made for us, for the blood that was poured out for us and his body that was broken. So we have three tables, one in the back. We also have a gluten-free option. Come and take communion as you feel. I'm going to do a quick prayer. Lord, we thank you for their sacrifice, for giving your life for us, for pouring out your blood, for your forgiveness, God. We take this moment to remember your sacrifice. In your name I pray. Amen. And if you want to join us in worship after, you can stand to your feet. The King of love had given up his life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse his blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. But not the end it could have known. For the earth began to shake. And the veil was torn. One sacrifice was made. As the heavens roared. And all hail King Jesus. All hail the Lord of heaven and earth. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Savior of the world. All hail
Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly because he feared the Jewish leaders. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who earlier visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with the spices and stripped linen. This was in accordance with Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new tomb, in which no one had ever been laid. Because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. So as we close this very special service, I want to encourage you guys to take this week, to take the rest of Holy Week, to really reflect on what the sacrifice of him dying, of what the death meant, of what his spilling of his blood meant for us in our own personal lives. That this isn't something that we would leave like we left our things in the basket by the cross, but this is something that we would keep with us. Let's pray. Jesus, we just thank you for your sacrifice on the cross. Lord, we just thank you for the mercy and the love that you showed by coming down here. And that as we spend this week, as we spend leading up to Friday, God, just mourning the sorrowful part of you dying, of the breaking of your body, God, the spilling of your blood, the pain that you had to endure, that you had to suffer, Lord. That in those moments, in the tension of those moments, God, that we would just be reminded of how near that you are to us. So, Lord, we just close this time with a gratefulness, a deep reverence for you, God. Lord, may we never go a day without being in awe and wonder of you and what you have done for us, Lord. In your name we pray, amen. So we'll have the chapel code up here, but before that, I just want to send you to go and just remember that. Be reflective, be reminded of that as you go through the week. Be blessed.
Get used to this.
this moment. Your fragrance is all around. I could get used to this. Oh, there's nothing like your presence. Oh, there's nothing like your glory. And I could get used to this. We want more of you.
You're here with me. Wonderful. on Christ alone, our chief cornerstone. No other foundation